I'm Bill McWilliam, president of Cascadero Copper, CCD on the TSX Venture Exchange. Cesium is one of the world's rarest metals with a growing industrial demand. Drilling is underway on our Tehran property in Argentina to prove up a cesium resource. Cascadero's patent-pending leach process has the potential to make Cascadero the lowest-cost supplier of cesium in the world. Visit our website, cascadero.com, or phone us at 604-924-5504.
You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio, available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. Welcome to HowStreet.com Radio, the online source for market opinions. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Tim Cyclesman Wood, editor of Cycles News and Views on Cyclesman.com. Welcome back to the show, Tim, and Happy New Year.
Thank you again, and Happy New Year.
The Dow Industrial Average topping 25,000. And it doesn't look like it wants to stop at all. Is it going to just keep on climbing? Some people have even mentioned 40,000.
Evidently. You know, back, I can never remember from one interview to the next what we really talk about. We talk about the current affairs, if you will, the current state of the market. But, you know, back in November, mid-November, the market was literally on edge. We had a couple of the DNA markers in place. We had an intermediate term sell signal as we rolled into that, or tried to roll into an intermediate term low, and then poof, it vanished. You know, everything was morphed away once again, like we've seen all year, and up it's gone. The DNA markers were negated. They never stuck. You know, you get the markers. It's a process. You see the markers. They're a warning, and then you get a Dow theory primary bearish trend change to solidify them. Well, they've never solidified this year. You know, we'd see them try to set up, or I say this year, 2017, we never saw them solidify. They'll try to set up, and then it just morph away. So it's more of the same. And, you know, I agree. It's the craziest thing. I think any market savvy technician on the planet realizes, like I said, it sounds like a broken record, the bubble that it is. But Jim, until we get those markers to stick, and when I say stick, I mean in solidified with a Dow theory primary bearish trend change, I agree. I mean, hell, it's just gonna, you know, there's nothing to stop it. So, like I said, I know it's a two-part message, and I don't mean to sound like I'm talking out of both sides of my mouth, but I mean, it is a bubble. I mean, I was back, I was listening to some old interviews, and I ran across something where even Trump talked about it being a bubble before the election. And so, I mean, I think anybody with any kind of market savviness at all knows that. So I don't mean to talk out of both sides of my mouth. I don't want it to sound like that. Yes, it was a bubble a year and a half ago. It's a bubble 6 months ago. It's a bubble now. Nothing has stuck. Nothing has stopped it. And until it does, you know, it's got a green light to continue. And we have to see those markers. You know, that's the thing. They've got to appear and be solidified. And the reason I say that is that, you know, there's no top in history going back to 1896, the inception of the Dow Jones Industrial Average, in which those markers haven't appeared. The one thing that was frustrating in 2007 is that they would, you know, a couple of them, two or three of them, they would appear and then they'd morph away, and they'd appear and then they'd morph away, and they'd appear and they'd morph away. And so every time they'd appear, it'd be a little bit of a warning, but then, like I said, they could never be solidified with a primary bearish trend change. So, you know, the can's just been kicked down the road, and you know, like I said, until they appear, there's no warning, and until a warning is solidified with a primary bearish trend change, it is what it is. It, you know, the bubble looks like it's just going to continue to get bigger.
One of the things that, on a year wrap-up show that I did, that my guest mentioned, he said the market in the last year did not appear to be influenced by geopolitics. It didn't matter how bad things got with relations with North Korea or the situation in Syria. The markets just kept marching along to their own tune. And Tim, you have told us in the past, you don't follow the news. You just look at the cycles. Is that what you saw? The cycles were just there and they didn't seem to be influenced from the outside.
Of course. I mean, the cycles are actually been extended, and that's been another one of the issues, is that, for example, we know that there's this little annual cycle that averages about 12 months, 12 months and some change, you know, 12 and a half months, something like that. Well, it, and you measure that cycle from low to low. Well, we know that, I mean, it's anybody can look at a chart if you point it out to them and they go, oh yeah, there, okay, I see it. But there was a annual cycle low that occurred last November. I say last November, November of 16, right ahead of the election, and then we ramped up out of that cycle coming out of the election. Well, it averages 12 months. So ideally, you know, that cycle should have peaked probably in August or September-ish, you know, something like that, rolled over into the low in the fall, and then given us a normal and reasonable correction in the market, a breath, you know, you breathe in and you breathe out, you know, it goes both ways, had a normal correction in the market, and then up again, provided that the markers didn't appear, which they didn't. So that said, we haven't even seen the rollover into that cycle. That cycle is even extended and stretched. So it's just about no matter how you look at this thing, it is extended and stretched. But at the same time, and again, I don't mean to sound like I'm talking out of both sides of my mouth, that it's a double message here. I mean, yes, it's extended and stretched even at that level, but we have to have those markers to cap it, and they have to solidify. And so, yes, the market has shrugged off everything, and it has just extended and extended and extended.
We'll have more with Tim Cyclesman Wood right after the break.
Cypress Development Corp's flagship lithium project is located just east of Albemarle's Silver Peak Mine in the heart of Clayton Valley, Nevada. A 12-hole exploration drill program for lithium-enriched claystone on Cypress's 100% controlled properties is now underway. Cypress Development Corp trades on the TSX Venture Exchange, symbol CYP, the Pink CYDVF, and on Frankfurt C1Z1. For more information, please visit our website, cypressdevelopmentcorp.com.
Glance Technologies owns and operates Glance Pay, a disruptive mobile payment technology now live in 16 cities in Canada and about to launch in the U.S. With revenues up 664% in the last quarter, Glance Technologies has the potential to be a worldwide leader in an industry projected to grow to $1.3 trillion in 3 years. Glance Technologies stock symbols are GLNFF in the U.S. and GET in Canada. Find out more at glancepay.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Tim Cyclesman Wood. Tim, what do you expect for gold, and how will silver perform this year as well?
Well, I'm working on my letter as we speak this week, be out this weekend. And, you know, the last time we talked, I have the charts on my desk, and I don't remember exactly what we said, but I have the charts on my desk, and I'm pretty sure we talked about the fact that there was a short and intermediate term cycle low in mid-December, December the 12th to be exact. Then we had a short-term buy signal occur the very next day on December the 13th in gold. We knew going into that low, I mean, it was a perfect, I mean, just real, I mean, just classic, perfect timing for a short-term and an intermediate term low. And obviously, we've advanced quite nicely coming out of that low. We've seen the same thing with silver. We've seen the same thing with the gold stocks, HUI, the XAU. The same low occurred on the 12th, same date. And then even on the CRB index, which is, you know, we talk about the commodities, so the commodity complex in general, it also bottomed there with short and intermediate term low. In the case of the metals, you know, I know that it's frustrating for the gold bugs, and it's frustrating for me trying to, you know, put this message out there, but it still looks like a countertrend advance. And again, that's not to talk out of both sides of your mouth. We knew it was an intermediate term low going into December, and we had short and intermediate term buy signals. And for the record, as of this conversation, both of those signals are still intact. So the advance is intact. Now, I think that we're close to at least a short-term top, and then I need to see it, you know, whether or not it evolves into the intermediate-term top, which ideally it should, because this should still be a counter-trend advance and a washout into, you know, that 9-year cycle low. And I know that sounds crazy. I get it. But as I think we talked about, we have the statistic you know, the higher level statistics telling us that, that the 9-year cycle low is still ahead because we haven't had that ninth, we haven't completed that ninth seasonal cycle, and some of the other structural things that have not happened to negate or to show us that there has been an exception, at least not yet, it hasn't. And so we have to operate under the assumption that the original premise is correct and that the 9-year cycle low still lies ahead. And I also see that still with the CRB index, which tends to confirm that. So, and in the gold stock. So it's all looking at the structure telling us that in spite of the fact that we've had this, this intermediate term rally as strong as it has been. And then to the, to kind of that same, on that same note, you know, we had a, I think it was a little later, it was December the 18th was the last, well, there was two of them, kind of back to back, like a little double bottom. We had another little short term, low in crude oil, and we knew then that it was retesting, an intermediate in what should be, you know, that annual degree cycle top there as well, and that advanced too. It's still intact. It's, I mean, no question about it. But again, I think that the commodity complex, as of steel, it looks like that it's pushing into what should be a significant top. Now, that said, something else is going on. The dollar, I don't know, I'm sure we've talked about this, but the dollar back in September, it should have made a long term as a 4-year cycle low in the dollar. And as of, again, this conversation, it still appears that that low was the 4-year cycle low. The dollar has retested that low, and now it should be also be at an intermediate degree low. And so what's about to happen is we're about to either see a major failure of the dollar, and then we may prove that commodities, hey, something else is going on. Maybe we prove then that, hey, the 9-year cycle low did occur back in 2015, and we've seen something we've never, ever, ever seen before in gold, with a very early 9-year cycle low that only contains 7 of these annual cycles, or the dollar's about to get a bid, and it's going to rip, and it's going to cap the commodities and gold and everything else. So we're at that juncture. And, I don't know. My thinking is, if you look at it, just look at the numbers, statistically speaking, we should see the dollar hold, commodities top, and then I think that will spill over into equities with some sort of a top, but not the top. I do not think equities would be done here, even if we saw a top now. I do not think they're done.
We'll have more with Tim Cyclesman Wood right after this.
Hi, I'm Douglas Mason, President and CEO of Magnum Gold Corp. Inc., MGI on the TSX Venture Exchange. A 2015 drill program on the LH property intersected high-grade gold, including 16.9 meters of 13.58 grams and 11 meters of 20.66 grams per ton gold. A follow-up drill program is planned to further evaluate previously identified subsurface high-grade gold mineralization. Please visit our website at magnumgoldcorp.com.
Keep informed. Receive our weekly recap of thought-provoking articles, podcasts, and radio delivered to your inbox for free. Sign up for the HowStreet.com weekly recap on our homepage, HowStreet.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Tim Wood. Tim, the price of oil has stayed above $60 for quite some time. This is usually a weak part of the year for oil. And now I'm getting two different points of view. Either it's going to go up, maybe hit 100, and some people are saying it can't sustain the $60 mark, and it may dip into the 30s. What's your point of view?
I think it's my camp is it's going lower. I do believe that. And look, there's no question about it that the rally has been stronger than anticipated. There's no question about it. Like I said, we had the intermediate term buy signals, that, so I'm not standing in front of the freight train. I want to be clear on both sides of the message. But I do think that the entire commodity complex, I mean, the evidence has not changed that it, including oil, metals, all of it, is pushing into a significant top. And I think that the key is going to be, you know, the cycle with the dollar. We need to see the dollar and commodities confirm each other by both of them, you know, the cycle turns taking hold. And that's what I'm going to be discussing in the current letter in great detail. That's going to be our focus over the next probably 30 days or 60 days. We should see this. we should see resolution of this. And you know, someone else sent me, I forget who it was, a subscriber, but they sent me something. I'm getting all kinds of stuff, you know, stuff that's very, very bullish about gold. And then I'm also getting a few things people are sending to me asking questions about, there was some other analyst that I'm not sure who it was, but he was talking about the collapse and how the collapse in gold was going to take, you know, cost trillions because people have jumped on this bandwagon. So I understand the confusion and frustration for investors about the commodity complex and particularly gold. But, you know, you have to, it's just like our Dow Theory founding fathers said about Dow Theory and the trend. You know, once a bullish primary bearish trend or a bullish primary trend change occurs or a bearish primary trend change occurs, you have to assume, I mean, you can have an expectation that, hey, we're operating in a bubble or, hey, we're moving into a low or whatever, that's fine. But that trend change stays in effect until it is reversed. And it's the same thing with the structure looking at these cycles. You know, the structure and the evidence tells us that this is a countertrend advance as strong as it's been. And so until we get evidence that says otherwise, then it's a countertrend advance, which means that once it tops, we go lower. So, like I said, it's a dual message. Separate the two. But no, I think overall commodities are moving into a top, and as of this time, I think that oil does go lower. But here's to your point. The other thing is that talking about the seasonality. Yes, it is a lot unseasonal because typically the seasonality is that you have rising oil prices coming out of the early spring or mid-spring, something like that, into the driving season, and then you tend to have lower oil prices going into, you know, this time of the year and, you know, maybe January, February, whatever, that time of the year. And so, yes, this is unseasonal.
Tim, thank you so much for chatting with us.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
My guest has been Tim Cyclesman Wood, editor of Cycles News and Views on cyclesman.com. You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio. Our Twitter channel is at HowStreet. Our YouTube channel is Talk Digital Network. Questions for the show can be sent to info@HowStreet.com. I'm Jim Goddard. Thanks for listening.
Comments made on HowStreet.com Radio are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any matter whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. HowStreet.com Radio is a production of HowStreet Media Incorporated.